Good afternoon. I know it's the last day of the talk and end of the evening, but we just had tea. Come on. Good evening. Yes, let's have some enthusiasm. Let's end it with a bright note. Myself, Jayendran, and thanks for the introduction. So, how many of you here know something about optimization problems? A few hands. Okay. Have you used any optimization solvers? Anyone? Used anything? You tried? Okay. So today's talk, since audience is quite diverse, I'll maybe spend a little bit about what optimization is all about, and then maybe introduce you to some solvers, and then say how we can use solve these optimization problems. Yeah. Next. Next. This is fine. So basically, an optimization problem, what do we want to solve? We want to, it's a form of mathematical model where we have a set of decision variables we want to decide such a way that they satisfy various set of constraints and which minimize or maximize some particular objective function. So that is the last line. So in other words, we want to find the decision variables such that they satisfy the set of constraints and they achieve the minimum maximum objective value, which can be unbounded also, or it can be infeasible. Some nuances are there. So this is what we essentially want to do. We want to find the best set of combination from an available set of total combinations that are available to solve a particular problem. So this is a very classical way in which we are going to formulate various kind of problems we have as optimization. We pose them as optimization problems and try to solve them. Even, I don't know, people with CS background, like when the shortest path problem is a classical optimization problem. Many paths we have to choose the shortest path. For some of those things, we have what we call as the Dijkstra's algorithm. We have exact algorithms to solve them. But then there are other class of problems like knapsack problem. We don't have any exact problems to solve them. There are any other kind of algorithms that are out there that may be fine-tuned for a specific problem. In optimization, what we try to do is we try to formulate it as a mathematical model and try to use a general solvers, what we call as a linear programming solvers, to solve these class of optimization problems. The interesting thing about it is that if I have a algorithm to solve some linear programming problem, then the same algorithm can be used to solve any linear programming problem or any programming problem. Because efficiency may be different, but can be used. So in general, we typically operate in a deterministic domain where all the parameter system is known. In those kind of systems, the decision variables can either be continuous or it can be integers or binary variables. If the decision variables are deterministic, there is one class called as linear programming problems where all the constraints and all the on the objective function is also just a linear function of the decision variables. In that case, we call linear programming problems. And we have exact algorithms to solve linear programming problems. For nonlinear programming problems, if any one constraint is nonlinear, for example, if I say x squared is less than or equal to 5, that is a nonlinear. Or x into y is equal to 5, that is nonlinear. In that case, these classes are called as nonlinear programming problem. We have only a few algorithms which can solve, and almost nothing guarantees the global optimum. Everything can give a local optimum. Some perform better than the other, but there is no universal nonlinear programming model. But linear programming is very useful. Many problems, though in the face looks like nonlinear, can be converted into linear programming problem and solved using exact algorithms. When I say exact, using that algorithm can guarantee an optimum solution if it exists. May not be in reasonable time, but you can find it. So those, so we are going to be looking at this linear programming models, how to formulate it and solve it. Next. So this is just to give a motivation. So where all we are going to see these optimization problems, we see in a varieties of fields in, say for example, scheduling of buses and trains, we can use optimization, transportation network design, supply chain optimization, a variety of things like say optimum circuit design of PCBs or Postgres optimization problems, design optimization and various mechanical, electromechanical systems, process optimization of chemical industry, that is also typically Postgres optimization. Actually, process optimization moves more into nonlinear side, but still quite useful. Designing of sharing network, yeah, like network sharing, like file sharing network, How do you design? How do I position my servers across the globe? How do I do the mirroring? All those are very clear, very nice optimization problem that can be nicely posed and used. Next. The time. So the popular optimization solvers that are out there are the Cplex, Gurobi, GLPK, the CLP, CBC, IPAOT are part of Coinoir, Lindo, Lingo. There are various other softwares. The Cplex is currently promoted by IBM. It's free for educational purposes. So if you are from educational institution, you are a faculty, and you can get it free, freely installed in all the computers in your education institution. Is absolutely free. However, big problems can also be solved. You don't need to buy Cplex. IBM gives it free for all educational institutions. Your faculty out there, to just install it. So highlighted in red the GLPK, GNU, LPKit, and this other acronym stands for something, but I will go into it later. So they are all open source. They are available. This CoinOR is actually a repository where various kind of optimization solvers have been coded and put online. We are just joined by Professor Ashutosh, who has contributed to the CoinOR repository itself. So I won't say anything extra about that CoinOR. He will find faults in that. So I'll just say that they have this nice package called as CLP, CBC, IPAOT, which has been developed and available out there. Other packages also available. You feel free to explore CoinOR. Type in Google, you should get it. So now the Python interface for optimization is provided by this Pulp and this OpenOP. These are two quite popular ones. So the Pulp are used for LP models, and OpenOP can be used for both LP and non-LP models. Internally, they are not building any new software engine. What they are actually doing is, for example, this Pulp. From Pulp, I can call Cplex. From Pulp, I can call the CLP solver. From Pulp, I can call the CBC solver. So first, I had to install the solver. Then using this Pulp, I just solve it. We are going to, since CLP, CBC, IPAOT are also available as open source, we'll use those solvers. They are also very good. So we can install them, use Python as a front end to write our optimization model and give it to this Pulp and give it to this CLP or CBC to solve, which will solve and give us the results. Otherwise, just talking to the solvers is not very easy. Then you have to be giving a huge zero and matrices, which is not very, very difficult to handle. And how do you even specify the constraints, which is also not easy. So that is why the power of Python is being used to help talk to these packages. OpenOP also talks to other packages. Some of which are not, but they, unfortunately, OpenOP doesn't provide interface to this CoinOR and GLPK. Many are kind of commercial tools that OpenOP supports. That's why we are just going to focus on Pulp, because the backend is also open source, front end is also open source. So we are all in the clear. So we'll just focus on Pulp. Pulp is linear programming modular written in Python. Pulp can call any solver, GLPK, CoinOR. It also has support for commercial solvers like Cplex. So for education institutions, as I told, Cplex is free. So you can also feel free to download, install, and use it for any amount of use to solve linear integer, mixed integer problems. So only these three categories. Nonlinear programming is not yet part of this Pulp. Maybe next year, if we have a tutorial, maybe it will be part of the thing, but it's clearly expanding. So to install it, we need to just go to this website and install Pulp, just like we install any other package of Python. We just install this, and then we just import Pulp as a module. Let's quickly go rest here next. Just fine. So I'm just skipping because the 2 days of training, I'm sure you would know how to import a module and put it inside. So two things we need to do in any optimization model. One is to define the decision variable, then write the constraints, write the objective function. These are three things that we need to do. The first step in designing, of course, you have to import Pulp. And once we do that, decision variable is, we just have to use that function LP variable to define a decision variable. Along with, when you define it, we can define the bounds of decision variable. And what is the category? Is it integer or is it a continuous variable? It will be defined. And then we can formulate a problem, which is either maximization or minimization problem. And then define constraints, which are just mathematical equations, has to be written. Next. Which we just keep adding to the problem. So that is the overall structure of the entire thing. First, we define a problem, and the decision variables, then the problem, and keep adding constraints and equations to the problem. and then solve the problem and get the output from the status. So here we are solved by the coin over solver. We can set any other solvers also that we want. So let me just show a quick example to better illustrate it. Let's go to the example. Too difficult to remember all these function names, but this is a very classical problem in optimization called as a blending problem. Those who don't know, it's also fine. So basically what we have is we want to produce three type of paints, exterior, interior, and a theme paint. And input, we have two raw materials, M1 and M2. We just need to figure out how much paint of exterior paint, interior paint, or theme wall paint has to be produced by the company. All the three uses, for example, raw material one ton is used in exterior paint, 2 tons is needed for interior paint, and 3 tons is used in theme paint, but total availability is 10 tons. Or if you read it, like for example, to make interior paint, I need 2 tons of raw material one and 1 ton of raw material two. And the profit per ton is also listed. What you want to find is the optimum mix of interior, exterior, and theme paint that maximizes the total daily profit. This is how the classical optimization model is posed. So next slide. So when we translate it into a mathematical formulation, so this is step one. We don't have time to go into that. So we'll assume that this part is also available to us. So for example, X1, X2, X3 are how much I want to produce exterior paint, tons produced daily of interior paint, and tons daily produced of exterior theme paint. Then objective would be to maximize profit. Profit was given in the last row, how many 1,000 rupees for X1, 1,000, 2,000 for type 2 paint, 3,000 for type 3 paint, it is all listed. Subject to the constraints, is one for each, because raw material cannot exceed, raw material 1 is used in X1, 2X2 plus 3X3 less than or equal to 10, that is for the first raw material. The second raw material is X2 plus 2X3 less than or equal to 5, that is for the second one, followed as X1, X2, X3 greater than or equal to 6. So this is a mathematical formulation that we have. So we want to capture similar form in my pulp so that I can easily code it. So do you have it in slide or you go to the, okay, let's go to, okay. So I'm just showing you the notebook viewers, but it should also work in Canopy or any other thing. But by default, I don't think pulp comes, so you have to import pulp part of it. So you can see the first line is to import pulp. Then I define the problem here, LP problem. I can give whatever name I want, and I'm going to maximize it. Then I define three variables, X1, X2, X3, as we listed. So LP variable, this is just a label, X1. 0 is a lower bound, none means upper bound is infinity. And then it is a continuous variable. That's what I say, LP continuous. So this, whatever begins with LP is a keyword for this pulp. So I simply define the three variables, X1, X2, X3. So let me, let me contrast it with okay, where is the, okay. I just want to quickly contrast it. For example, as you can see, the mathematical version, I just defined X1, X2, X3 the same way I'm just defining X1, X2, X3. I just wanted to show the equivalence. And then for the problem, so problem is a maximization problem. So we define problem is to maximize something. So we define a problem which is to maximize something. So the to that problem, I first add the objective function. Objective function is added to the problem first. So whatever you add is objective function. So problem plus equal to, problem is defined as LP problem. 1000x1 plus 2000x2 plus 3000x3, which is exactly the same as you see here. So since the interface is exactly the same as how you write mathematical forms, very easy to type it. Else we are going to go nuts trying to type it out. And the constraints are then added subsequently. The main thing differentiates is this right hand side, which you can just write it. So problem plus equal to x1 plus 2x2 plus 3x3 less than or equal to 10, which is exactly the same format as you see in equation 2 and equation 3. You just write them here. And then the equation 4, x1, x2, x3, so this is on the bounds are the decision variables. So if I'm just going to write, say, x1 less than or equal to 4, but x1 greater than or equal to 0, so I don't need to write it as a constraint. I can write it in the definition itself, where I just say LP variable x1, and then I write 0 comma 4 comma, I think LP continuous, something was there. So I can just define it in the definition of the variable itself, because variable can has to be bounded within this. We write it as an equation only when two or more variables are involved in that. Then I write it out as LP problem, and then I just problem.solve, it is going to solve it out. And once it is solved, I can just print the status. The status will give me whether the problem is optimum, whether when it's solved, did it find an optimum solution. Or sometimes the problem can be infeasible if the constraints clash. So, you know, I cannot say that whatever. If this problem is clearly infeasible, x1 less than equal to 4, x1 greater than equal to 8, cannot happen. So that time it has to say that problem is infeasible. Or sometimes problem also becomes unbounded. Like maximizing profit is going to infinity, then it has to. Then it will say it is unbounded and no, I can't wait forever. So that is the status. So once I have the status, I can print all the decision variables and along with it the name and the value in tons, and I can also print the value of the objective value, probability of objective. So since it's already solved here, or we can solve it again. It says x1 is 2.5 tons, x2 is 0 tons, and x3 is 2.5 tons, resulting in a maximum daily profit of how many zeros? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 is 1 crore. 10 power 7 is 1 crore, right? Anyway, some really large number, and this is fine. So that's actually pretty much enough how we are using it. No. It can't just be 0. I need to know the values of x1, x2, x3, which will do that. Internally, this is a symbolic math. Yeah, that's it. That's pretty much the symbolic math that is happening here. But only thing is, since you see pulp, you don't need to use SymPy also. I said use SymPy and use definition two times. It's part of the pack. They're handling it.
So when you solve, it's actually calling out to some other packet.
It is calling out that coin or that CBC. In this case, it will call CLP package. Meaning? What is it doing?
Same process.
It's part of the pulp. It's called the library. No, there's no initial value. The problem is in a data structure, which is the no. So just to show that. So it's continuous. So for example, I told it can be also integer variable. Let us assume that x1, x2 can be only integers. That is, I can only produce integer quantities of paint. Currently the output was 2.5, it's continuous scale. Suppose you say an integer is possible, then let's see what happens. So let's solve it. Now if you solve it, okay, x1 is 4 tons and x3 is 2 tons, and because the profit in this case happens to be the same thing, need not always happen to be the same thing. So looks like we have multiple optimum solutions in this case. So these are two categories that is possible. Now, That is the first very, very basic model. But at that level, it's very difficult to scale. Like suppose I have 100 variables, I can't define x1, x2, x3 up to 100, and then thousands of constraints, I'll go nuts just trying to define the optimization model. So we want to have more and more compact representation of the same. For that, already we have nice data structures available with us in Python. That is, we'll just use extensive use of dictionaries and lists and loops to define a lot of constraints instead of trying to write out all these constraints. Suppose 100 constraints, I can't write it in plus equal to, I'll just go mad. So one option is to use Python's inbuilt structure of lists and dictionary. For example, suppose let us define a list called paints, which is nothing but three decision variables I want, exterior paint, interior paint, and theme paint. Then let me define a dictionary of, so that's a profit. I get 1,000 rupees for every ton of exterior paint, 2,000 for every ton of interior paint, 3,000 every ton of theme paint. I can define a dictionary of it. And same thing, raw materials. That is the first constraint. We told the raw materials, exterior paint uses 1 ton, interior paint uses 2 ton, theme paint uses 3 tons. And raw material 2, exterior paint uses 0 tons, interior paint uses 1 ton, and exterior paint, theme paint 2 tons. So you can define these nice data structures. And then again, I define LP problem, LP maximize. Now I have to again define the variables, which is nothing but from this dictionary of paint. And then zeros, I think the lower bound is fine. So here, now the objective function is to be added. So problem basically LP sum of profit into paint variables. So everything will be multiplied by the paint variables. What I'm multiplying? Nothing but the profit for all I in paints. As you can see, just a simple idea. If I had to use the same names here, for each of these, I'm just constructing a dictionary. I'm just like the idea of a primary key, and I'm just using that. So profit I into paint of I for I in paints. I can just use this structure to define my objective. And similarly, I can do it for other constraints. LP sum of raw material 1 into paints for I in paints, and raw material 2 into paint for I in paints. I can define my constraint. So this can help me reduce my problem complexity, and only thing I have to update is now what we have done is we have successfully created data file. So any changes I have to make, I don't need to touch my model at all. If tomorrow I say, okay, profit is not 1,000, it's 1,100, I just change it up here, I don't need to worry about the entire model. So I get two level of abstraction in this. Other part remains the same, I solve it, I get the status, I print the values and print the objective, which will of course solve to the exact same thing because it's the exact same model. Okay, in the interest of time, let me just go back. Just for advanced users of optimization who are, or rather, just to show there is more possible thing. Just leave it. To show that one huge application network optimization model. Suppose we have multiple suppliers and we have multiple demand points. The problem is I need to figure out which suppliers are on and how much quantity supplied from A to B. So this problem becomes two-dimensional problem. Next slide. Okay, the classical version of this, I'll just quickly mention, is that I need to figure out which supplier to open, that is decision variable I'm reading out, yi, if the supplier is open or not. This is one-dimensional. But I need to determine how much quantity of product is transferred from supplier I to customer j. That's a two-dimensional decision variable. Okay. Currently, we just saw how to define decision variables. Now, if it's two-dimensional, suppose I index goes up to 100 and j index go up to 1, then the number of decision variables I need to create is enormous. So how do we make it a nice compact way? So other inputs are usually considered are the cost and demand and capacities. So let's just go to the model. The typical network optimization model looks something like this, where minimize Z minimizes a product of the transportation cost, Xij and Cij, plus the fixed cost incurred in opening a supplier. Subject to the total demand, the total quantity that is supplied to a customer should be equal to the demand of that customer J. That is first constraint. Second is the total quantity supplied from a supplier should be less than the capacity of the supplier. The capacity is indicated by the K. So this is, and these YIs are binary, but K, XIs are continuous. I'll just quickly show a demo of how it can be done. So pulp import this thing. Unfortunately, in 2D, use of names is still not so freely possible. So suppose demand supply region is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and there are 9 demand regions and 4 supply regions. Let us give it as this index names. And we are defining lists for each of those input parameters. And distances will be a 2D matrix because from I to J I have to go. But dividing it as a 2D list. And all are just lists here. You're not using any dictionaries because this itself is quite complex. So the two dimension variable is open. So whether the supply region is open or not, binary. Second is quantity shipped, which is a dictionary of quantity. Again, here I'm defining a two-dimensional thing. I and J for I in supply region and J in demand region. So I do list comprehension here and try to make it as a 2D thing. So this way, this quantity shipped is now a nice 2D dictionary of LP variables for all these I cross J. It can be nice, compactly representation is possible. And now we had two constraints. And using this power of Python, I just have to do this for every demand region. I just add the quantity shipped. There is some from all the supply regions is equal to the demand J. So I can neatly represent your mathematical form to very similar language in Python. So for example, here we written for all J in J. That's exactly right. For J in demand regions, LP sum. Sum over what? Quantity shipped over I in supply region. So I'm summing over I here. So that is the same I in supply region. Here, I in supply region. Equal to DJ, equal to demand J. So the if you have an interface which gives, you know, mathematically is what we are used to learning and used to doing, and so the similar interface is there, it minimizes your errors. Now this constraints also can be captured. Sum of quantity shipped for all J in demand region less than equal to K of I into open 1 of I, which are again different Bayesian variable above. Then I write it, solve it, get the status, and then once the output has come, if you see the output is also pretty much like a list structures that we have. So whatever Python you are used to handling lists and dictionaries can be used to modify whatever outputs that you want. So if you can say I'm just printing for region, supply region, print the supply region names is open if, then I can add whatever, only display if it is open, else, okay, why is it not scrolling? Anyway. Oh, sorry. I can combine it to any kind of Python whatever syntax structure into my output data structure. And if I solve it, this kind of the output I got. Kadapa open, Hyderabad closed, Kurnool open, Vijayawada open. And the quantity shipped from various centers to the various destinations is also presented along with the optimum output in this particular case. So that's just about time I have. This is just to give a brief introduction, the possibility of solving optimization problem using Python. It's not just for statistics, writing code can also solve optimization problem by, and which can be non-trivial. These are non-trivial problems. Any big problems also can be attempted. It's not just a small baby version. It's fully functional optimization package. So I'll just stop there. Take any questions. Okay, this doesn't handle dynamic systems. What is the solver for dynamic systems? I have not used it, but there are some ODE integrators must be able to do something on that. What is this? Type A itself has some support to do it. But this doesn't do that. It won't handle dynamic systems. It will only handle deterministic systems. One optimization has a lot of classes of problems. And depending on the class, we have different solver. Some basic optimization, like for example, any curve find a minimum maximum point. Just SciPy is enough to do that. You don't need anything. Even SimPy, whatever, various packages give the basic ones. Same thing, ODE solvers, because we have a lot of such packages. So this is just another class of package which is available for solving these special kind of problems. Oh yeah, even the last example, one variable is discrete, one is continuous. You just have to specify it. It says LP binary and LP other we don't specify, so it automatically means it's continuous. It can handle all combinations. I don't know how to respond. I have not used the opt. I have to see it. What is the largest?
I don't even know what are the hard performance problems, but in terms of performance, people say that the open source packages for linear operations have always been weak.
Right.
Suplex is supposedly super fast.
Yeah. So that's why I kept stressing that this has interface to Cplex also.
But are there any open source equivalents to Cplex which are reasonably fast?
Yeah, Cplex.
But it's similar in feature set to Cplex. CBC. It's part of coin.
So C is a coin or branch. So CBC coin or branch and cut, CLP is coin or linear programming solver. That's a kind of IP opt is there for integer programming specific solver. That's for Ashutosh. He also contributes to the coin or repository by building solvers and testing it out and playing it as his full time profession. I'm just a user like you guys.
Thank you.